Hallo. Hello. I thought a short update on OpenSSH security would be quite useful. And I think everybody knows why we use SSH, and most of you also how it works. So we skip the introduction part and go into the core features. One thing is, when I had my first OpenSSH talk, I got out and asked friends, people I know, why are you using SSH, why you like it, and they simply were saying it works, it just simply works. The tunneling magic is what you need, and yeah, it is a security protocol which just works, not like other ones which are a bit more difficult. So, what are the built-in security features in the protocol? At first, you have the modular support for crypto primitives, so you can, the protocol itself does not age, you can change the ciphers and other cryptographic protocols you have included. There's rekeying for longer sessions, so you can mitigation for attacks against the crypto protocol. Both sides are authenticated, which is not that common for other protocols. And you have three protocols, so transport protocol, a user protocol, authentication protocol, and a connection protocol. And so OpenSSH implementation supports privilege separation, so that not every session wants its root permissions. Have a look at the ciphers. So if I check out which ciphers I can check with minus big Q. What ciphers are there? Then the first ones I would not recommend to use. The later ones, the AES, GCM, are recommended for devices with IIS support included, and the SHA-SHA ciphers work better on ARM devices and which ones have no IIS support. And there's also recommended to use authenticated ciphers. So what, which one are these? These are the last ones, these which were black on the slide before. So these one are commonly recommended to use and seen as secure. What is else? I'm rekeying I had on the list before. So you can configure it, but the defaults are quite sane. So rekeying is, it specifies the amount of data that may be transmitted before a new session key is renegotiated. And the default is between 1 gigabit and 4 gigabits, depending on the cipher, or 1 hour if there is not that much traffic on. You can configure it, but the default is quite good. A short protocol recap. So at the base layer, we have the transport protocol where we authenticate the server side. On top, there is an authentication protocol where we authenticate the user. And the connection protocol is for the current ongoing sessions where we can have the shell, our forwarding channels, or the agent running or communicating over. So scenario, first scenario, server authentication. How do I authenticate the server? Most commonly, I guess, is the TOFU principle, where we have the trust on first use. So at the first time we connect, we have a prompt. Do you want to trust these keys? I think most spies will type yes. Then it's stored in a local database. What you also can do, you can pre-distribute a global known host file in etc, or wherever you want to distribute it. You can distribute the fingerprints in the SSH FP record. But then you need DNS security, for example, DNSSEC. I think that's even less common than to verify the keys correctly. In your client, you can configure the update host keys directive. Then a server can prompt multiple keys. So you can rotate the server keys, the host keys, and a user can, a client can learn new keys. And there's also the option to prompt if you want to learn new key or not. So it's configurable. And you can use SSHCA, which I speak about later. So we have omitted the TOFU principle with the last one. Other scenario, working remotely, I mean, everybody knows we can SSH to a simple host, then we have a password. It sucks somehow. Every time typing a complex password, but it's not gatherable, quite hard. Then we can use SSH keys, I think everybody knows as well. Then we can distribute it in either way to the server and log in with our key, but there's still a password. It still sucks, but in a more secure way. So let's have a look on the keys. In most distributed SS OpenSSH versions, there is the PIM format used, which has some design issues where you can brute force the key. So it's not recommended to use at the moment. With older SSH versions, you can create a new key with the minus O, then you use a new format, or using no SR keys, for example, the ED25519 keys, that's a secure, or in the new OpenSSH version, like 7.8 or 9, there is a new format, the default. If you want to check which one you can use, you can say file, and if you have the lower line, where say OpenSSH private key, which is also encrypted, you have the new format, which is more secure. Still prompting every time the password is, can be straining, so we can use the SSH agent. How does it work? I think most people know you can load your key in. And if you have a jump host with a shared user and you share the user with other colleagues or whoever, then you should know that the agent relies on the Unix file permissions. So if you share a user and the agent is running, everybody can, or with the same user, everybody can use your connection or your agent session as well with the local keys. What can you do? When you add the key to the keyring, you can say minus C, and then you have to type yes every time the key will be used. You can list the keys, you can delete all keys, you can delete one key, and you can lock your SSH agent if you go for a coffee break. So, at the first slide, we had limiting the ciphers we use. At the first line, you can also say to your client, OK, I just want to support these ciphers. Maybe there is a server where you cannot touch the configs, or it's not you have no permissions to do, and you want to have secure connections. So you can say in your client configuration, just offer these. And in the second block from line 5 to 9, you see we add the ciphers. For example, you have some older network gear which need triple desk keys or these old DSS keys for logging in. Oops, what's that? I don't want to do it. Can I say cancel? OK, excellent. So. No. Where's the slide? I have this Linux box at home, so I don't know. Ah, there, excellent. Wow, fancy. Ah, thanks. Thanks a lot. So from line 5 to 9, you can see you can extend the cipher list with ciphers which you deconfigured or which are not activated in general. For example, the DSS keys or the ciphers somehow are not activated in the default SSH configuration. So you have explicitly say, OK, I really want to use this old deprecated ciphers, which make me insecure. And you also can add other features like dynamic forward or having the forward agent only for certain hosts because of the insecurities I had in the last slide. So everything you can configure in your local configuration. So another scenario, the SSHCA. I mean, everybody knows the ID as R keys or the other key, but what are these certificates? I think not everybody knows. So in the initial RFC, there was stated besides the local database, which we know at own hosts, there's also a say R mentioned. But for later implementation, it is not really specified there. And today, we have the possibility to use SSHCA, which not relies on X509 certificates, but uses raw keys. So you don't have the hassle to pass the format there, RSN1. How it works, you create a key. You say, OK, you have a certificate authority and put it in your known host or authorized keys. And then you don't have to validate every key. You just have the CA feature for validating them. You can sign key. You can have a validity. You can sign in host keys and whatever. What it can do, I mean, if you want to automate it, you can fetch the key, you dedicate it to a signing host, because the CA should be quite more secure than on your notebook, and deploy the certificate beside that. Then you have a private key, a public key, and a certificate. There are also tools outside there which ease that a bit. And yeah, issues, vendor support, you have to call revocation, decommissioning, If you have short-lived certificates, you have to renew them. You can sign in the commands from the authorized keys. So we have, can force it because it's signed in, and you have a binding from user to keys. That's what's it.
Good. Thank you, André. We have time for one or two short questions, if there are any questions. Okay. Thank you. Oh, there's one question, sorry.
Hi, Stefan von Denig. Hello. I'm struggling a lot of times with the SSH agent thingy. Do you know any good approach to use agent forwarding, but without sacrificing or without enabling a security threat on the jump post or on the interim machine? Do you have any good idea?
Since it relies on the permissions, what I always do if I have certain agents running for certain customers, so I mean the client gets the agent from the environment variables. So I have a certain agent who is allowed on the specific key for that customer, and then I mitigate the issues with the jump post and other keys are misused. And you can have a check on the -c flag, so you have to accept when the key is used, so you get a prompt and you see it.
The idea to use different key sets for different customers is, I think, is a pretty good idea. Anyhow, because one day we did some sort of hack and say, now I'm logging in on your other customers because I know you use agent forwarding and you use the same key for the other customers. So this was some experiment we did someday.
What you also can do on the backup slides, you can have multiple authentication methods. You can say first public key and then password. So you mitigate just getting with the password in. So that's also possible.
Okay, thank you. One more question.
What about key revocation? Do you have any, if you use a CA feature, do you have any tips on that? Because having a CA is nice, but yep. What if you need to revoke it?
There exists a key revocation list, but be careful. With Debian old stable, I guess, there was this SSA version has the SSA CA implemented, but not the key revocation list. So the key revocation list is a bit newer than the SSA CA feature. But it exists, but then you have the problem to distribute the revocation list. So I would suggest for host key signing, maybe if your server is running for 3 years and then out of support, then having the key time validity limit on 3 years or 1 year and having every Easter renewing the certificates or something like that, because revocation is always a problem every CA.
Yeah, so you're back at step one again, and because if you have to distribute the revocation list, you could also just distribute the allowed keys.
And yep, for example.
Okay, thank you, André.